talk about two separate works, which are connected by the fact that in both cases it was pivotal the use of the strongly coupled ensemble Kammann filter. In the first part of the work, I will take a sort of idealized view, and I will try to see how much we can understand by using a linear analysis on the effect on a coupled system where the scale separation is only focused on the time scale. And I will also try to investigate what are the effects of the coupling on the normal mode of instability of the system. In the second part of the talk, I will mention about a combination of data simulation and machine learning to devise subgrid scale parametrization, whereby again the use of ensemble Kammann filter in coupled mode was pivotal. So this is a bit of the context, which I think is a bit redundant given the context here, and I'm sure that all of you know already. But just to remind that the problem of multiscale arises when modeling in general a continuous system in high resolution, or as is the case in climate science, when we couple together different subsystems. And in fact, the climate models are a classical example of system with temporal and spatial scale separation. So, in the context of data simulation, you know very well that probably the main issue is the fact that the scale separation makes it difficult to carry out the uncertainty quantification that it is necessary to propagate the information of data from one subcomponent of the model to the other. And it is known that if the scale separation is not very large, we can still rely upon an uncoupled data simulation in the sense that we run a coupled model and then the update is separated between the two subcomponents. And this is what usually called as weakly coupled data simulation. At the same time, however, we all know, and we have also seen in some of this talk today, how much we can gain by performing a strongly coupled data simulation, whereby this connection, so this data transfer, information transfer, happen across the boundary of the subcomponent, meaning, for instance, that observation of the ocean will impact the atmosphere and vice versa. So, in that context, let me take this sort of simplified and idealized view. Let's imagine that we are dealing with the coupled system of ODE, whereby X stands for my ocean, say, slow compost, slow variable, and Z stands for my fast variable atmosphere, and coupled together. And in this setting, in this simplified setting, as you can see, I'm assuming that the system are autonomous, so there is not an external time-dependent forcing there. And the variable, the quantity epsilon here accounts for the temporal scale difference between the two processes. So this is a very simplified view in which I'm only focused on the time scale separation. We all know very well that in the realistic cases, atmosphere and ocean are also, they also differ, of course, for the spatial scale. So at the same time, we're also assuming here that F and G, so the tendency for the atmosphere and the ocean, are all both bounded from above by the same quantity. So, of course, given this setup, the two model subcomponent will grow differently. So, if you take an interval of order one, the slow scale, of course, will change less than how much this fast scale will grow. So, it is clear already in this setting that we see that if, in order for the observation of the slow scale to monitor the variability of the slow scale, we need to have the interval of between observation to be bounded from above by this quantity here. The opposite situation is when we have very frequent observations. So we assume to have observation of the fast variable to be of the order, the interval, the order one. This is in a situation in which the slow system will be seen as approximately constant in that interval. And this, of course, is again a good scenario to applying weakly coupled data simulation. Now, if we take this system and we apply simple linearization analysis, these are the equations that look like. This will be the linearized evolution of the error, where, of course, you see clearly the appearance of the cross term. So the cross term indeed will describe the impact across compartment. So for instance, this term here will be the fast to slow dependence, and conversely, this term here will be the slow to fast dependence. Now, in the practical case, of course, this Jacobian here will encode all of the atmosphere. In the case of an atmospheric ocean coupled model, will encode all of the mechanical transfer of kinetic energy, heat transfer, and so on and so forth. Now we can use this equation to have a sort of approximation view on the error bounds. So I can take the norm of both cases here, and I can get equation three, and then I can use this equation three to get to get a sort of estimation of the error bound that I will get in each subcomponent. If I do now, if I use an equation tree and I assume like a very ideal situation, a situation in which the order of error in the forecast does not change with respect to the error in the analysis, which is of course a very ideal situation, but it can help us to get this sensitivity that I wanted to talk about. Then we get these two set of bounds, four and five, whereby we see already, obviously, that the fast scale bounds are much smaller. And this, of course, is an effect of having this this temporal scale separation exclusively. So the analysis error must be kept within the order one. Otherwise, any local large sensitivity of with respect to the fast variable beyond that threshold will lead to forecast error grow well beyond that. Now, obviously, when we do data simulation for state estimate alone, we do not act on the tangent linear model directly, which is what these f and g will be. They are related to the Jacobian, of course, but only on the trajectory upon which this Jacobian evaluated. And this also suggests that use the use of coupled data simulation to estimate the coupled parameter, to acting that directly on g and f is actually a desirable option. But what these analysis tell us to, by only focusing again on the temporal scale separation, is that we can conclude that the effect in between, within each of the subcomponent and across them can be like summarized along the following: that cross-compartment effect are generally stronger in direction from the slow to the fast scale. However, the inter-compartment effect are much stronger in the fast scale, which requires to be controlled by observation. And the rate at which the fast scale error is bound, if left at control, is such that it can quickly reach high level and thus affecting the slow scale too. So I will say that clearly at the first order at which this analysis concern, the conclusion will be that we need to observe the fast scale in order to get a good performance on the coupled data simulation. Now, some numerical experiment. I am using a spectral model, which is called MAU1, which has been developed by the group of Van Nitsem, Stefan Van Nitsem in Belgium. It's a spectral model, as I say, which couples together an atmosphere and an ocean. It's modular in the sense that you can play with a number of modes in the Fourier expansion such that you can increase or decrease the system. The type of mechanism of the coupling are, that the model describes are both thermical and mechanical. And the model is a solid spectral space, as I say, excuse me for repeating myself. I have worked with six different configurations where the first number indicates the number of modes I'm using, 36, 52, 56. And WK and ST represent respectively two different configurations of the model when the model is strongly coupled or weakly coupled. This has nothing to do with data simulation. It has to do with the strength of the couple between the two subcomponents. This is a visualization of the attractor of this system. You can see when the coupling between atmosphere and ocean is weaker, you have the classical view of a chaotic attractor. Of course, the system has dimension 36 in this example, so this is only a view on three specific dimensions of the phase space. When you increase the coupling between the ocean and the atmosphere, then the ocean started to have a sort of resisting effect against the atmosphere, so the system gets a bit less chaotic. It's still chaotic, but you can clearly see that there are two regimes, a regime of higher variability alternate with a regime of lower variability that are called, we will call it passive and active. The spectrum of the Lyapunov exponent for the configuration of the model that I'm considering is also very peculiar, and I will focus on this now. You can see that the increase of the size of the model primarily affects this bound of almost neutral modes. So it seems that when we had modes in the coupling, this sort of degeneracy of the spectrum of Lyapunov exponent appear. And this is a very difficult from the point of view of data simulation, because we in general knows that we may somehow try to not focus attention on the stable mode as they will eventually be dumped down. We focus on the unstable mode generally when we design an efficient ensemble Kalman filter. But what do we do with those set of almost unstable, almost neutral mode is very difficult to assess, because this asymptotically neutral mode can be instantaneously unstable. In order to get a better view on this, I look at the covariant Lyapunov vector, which are characteristic direction of instability of the system. Here I'm considering two versions of the model, the weakly coupled and the strongly coupled. We have the state ingots from 1 to 36 on the x-axis, and the projection of the covariant Lyapunov vector on average on top of each individual component on the left axis, sorry, on the y axis, yes. So you can see clearly here that there is a clear transition in projection. So the instability are either originated in atmosphere or in the ocean. This is seen by looking at this area, sorry, this area on top and then on the bottom. But then you see that there is this area which is very strange and very peculiar, whereby almost neutral covariantly Lyapunov vectors show a comparable projection on both the atmosphere and the ocean, which is this area that I'm indicating here. So it seems such so that these neutral nodes are indeed the manifestation of the coupling. So when we do couple data simulation, the conclusion here will be that we really need to rely on this neutral direction, if because they embed cross information between the atmosphere and the ocean, between the slow and the fast variable in this case. This is further investigated here, in which I'm showing in the left and center panel the angle between the space spanned by the ensemble and the space spanned by the most unstable, sorry, by the unstable on the leftmost and the unstable plus all of the quasi-neutral in the center. And what is important to remark is the similarity or the difference between the pattern of each one of these two of the left and center panel with respect to the rightmost panel, which represent the root mean square error of the analysis of the ensemble Kalman filter. And what we see here is that the convergence of the filter, so reduction of the root mean square error, happen when the ensemble subspace is able to capture all of the unstable plus the quasi-neutral modes that we would have otherwise left completely uncontrolled. And this is the same plot that you're seeing here, but integrated over all of the ensemble member. And you see that this is represent the angle and the root mean square error on the right hand y-axis as a function of the ensemble size. And you see that the difference between the blue and the red, on the blue and the green curve, is what matters, because it is only when we include all of the neutral mode that we are able to have the convergence of the error coincidentally when all of the ensemble, well, the ensemble is able to reproduce all of the neutral mode too. Regarding the effect of observing the fast scale as opposed to observing the slow scale, it is given this result here, which showed root mean square error as a function of different interval between data, between the observation, in an experiment in which we observe only the atmosphere in the left side, and an experiment in which we observe only the ocean in the right side. The root mean square error of the analysis is given in the red curve, while in the cyan is given the level of the observational error. What you can observe immediately is that by looking at the left-hand side bottom panels, is that when we only observe the atmosphere, as long as the frequency of the observation do not exceed 3 days, we are able to maintain the error in the ocean decently below the level of the observational error, which means that those observations in the atmosphere have been effective in controlling the error in the ocean too. The situations change completely in the when we look at the right hand side of the slide, in which we see that when we only observe the ocean, the error in the atmosphere goes well above the observational error, again in line of what was our conclusion by the simple linear analysis. The second part of the panel, in the minutes that I have left, the second part of the talk is about this combination of machine learning and data simulation that you have been working in recent time. Here, what we wanted to do is that we wanted to estimate this MUN, and where UN stands for the unresolved component, assuming that we already possess a physical model, which is intended here by MFI. So the goal of this part of the talk is about using a combination of machine learning and data simulation to estimate this right-hand side most term in this equation. So to do that, the proposed algorithm works according to the following workflow. We apply data simulation at each time tk by using the original physical model, so the model that we already possess and supposedly represent the best possible way of our knowledge of the system. And this process of assimilating data y is done by using a strongly coupled ensemble Kalman filter and produced the analysis xa. The second step is about determining an estimation of the unknown part of the model, and this is done by using as target in our machine learning step the analysis increment, which is taken here as a proxy of the model error. Then we train a neural network, which is essentially about minimizing the loss function with respect to the set of parameter theta, where again I insist that the target here is the analysis increment. And then in the final step, we sum up the two objects to construct our hybrid model, which is given by the sum of the two. We have been using the same model, MAU-AM, that I mentioned before, in a situation in which we have the truth represented by 56 models and the truncated model, which is used as a model, processes 36 model, and the difference between the two stands only in the 20 higher order atmospheric variable, which are not reproduced in our system. And that's why, and these are the results that I show here, that we have the root mean square error of the forecast at the lead time given in the parentheses here. As you can see, for the first two variables, which are of the ocean, these are for the 2 years, so it's long time, and 1 day for the atmosphere, and you see that we have an improvement with respect to the truncated model by using our hybrid model. The key point that I want to stress here is that the improvement is larger for the ocean that is fully resolved. So this is a proof of the fact that this is really an effect of the enhanced representation of the atmosphere ocean coupling processes that we were able to achieve thanks to the use of coupled data simulation. This is a final view on the same result by showing a projection of the attractor of the system, the true model on the top left, the truncated model on the top right, and the hybrid model constructed using data simulation and machine learning on the top right, where you can see that even if there are still a lot of area of the phase space which are populated by our model, which do not belong to the true, we are able to reproduce much better the higher populated area of the original attractor of the system. Conclusion, we have deduced a first-order dynamical mechanism for the error transmission within and across scale, which has shown that the cross-compartment effects are stronger in the slow-to-fast direction. However, the inter-compartment effects are much larger in the fast scale, which is the reason we believe to control the fast scale in order to be effective on the full system. These results have been confirmed using the coupled system MAU-AM. At the same time, we have shown that quasi-neutral modes are connected to the coupling must be accounted for in the coupled DI process. And then finally, we developed a combined data simulation machine learning method to build an hybrid model made of physical-based, past data-driven surrogate of the result scale. And in both cases, the use of coupled DA has been pivotal. Thank you. Sorry if I have exceeded a bit of the time. Thank you very much. These are the paper that I have used in this work.
Thank you very much, Alberto, for this very interesting talk. There's already one question from Sergei Frolov. He says, "Thank you for your presentation. How do you suggest we project your results to a real system?"
Well, it's a very good question. It's a very provocative question, and it's a question that I cannot answer in 2 words. It depends which part of the result. Definitely, the second part of the result, the one which has to do with the combination of machine learning and machine learning, those are by construction scalable, because there is those we have applied them to an idealized system because this is inherent to the type of research that we do. But you can plug in and plug out the more appropriate ensemble data simulation method on the one side and machine learning method on the other, which is also applicable to an i-dimensional system. One additional note to do, in that case, you can easily use in the data simulation method, which is not an ensemble base. We prefer to work with ensemble Kalman filter because in that way we could use also the analysis error covariance matrix as a way to in the process of minimizing the loss function of the machine learning step. Regarding the first part of the talk, on the other hand, you cannot take any recipe ready to use in practice. Rather, the idea here is that if the coupling per se then give rise to a change, to such a dramatic change in the spectrum of Lyapunov exponent, then this means that I think that the immediate consequence is that whatever type of design we have done for the ensemble Kalman filter for the two systems separately must be revisited.
Thank you very
Yeah.
much for Sorry?
No, I was saying, did I answer the question? I don't know. I don't see.
Sergey?
Thank you, Alberto.
Okay, thanks. There's one more question from Lars Nerger. He says, how far does the assimilation increment actually contain finer scale information so that the ML can learn from it?
Well, that of course it's a very good technical question and has not a unique answer. I think that it's very much state dependent, but it's even more than that. When you make the assumption that the analysis increment is a proxy of the model error, you are essentially assuming that the analysis is a very good reproduction of the truth, which is of course per se an assumption. So what you really have is a sequence of analysis increment, and you can think of those being representing of the difference between your model and the truth, which is the model error, as long as the analysis is really a good reproduction of the truth, which is not the case. In reality, you have a mix of the growth of the initial condition error and the error which comes by the fact that your model is not a perfect reproduction of the truth. Now, within these two, what distinguishing between the signal coming from the unresolved scale is not necessarily that easy to do, but in our setup, of course, the model error comes by the absence of some scales. We have not investigated how much we would be able to discriminate between one source of model error or another in experimentally.
Okay. Thank you very much again, Alberto.